Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Testing, testing. How's that sound, folks? Is that good for you? Let's do this. So, hello everyone and welcome to the Student Art Podcast. I'm your host, Ross Baxter, and today is episode 19 of the series. And as always, folks, the Student Art Podcast is a podcast designed around you, the students. And I've been doing these for a while now to support students in terms of the student education system and just using artists and basically just making sure I could provide you with the best material and resources as possible as I can. Just remember, I'm just providing it obviously from my perspective of what I've learned and so forth, and I really hope today's episode helps you out. So as always on the podcast, we talk about a variety of things. We bring on guests from a variety of different backgrounds and a lot of different types of art as well. Ranging from environment art, concept art, animators, lighting artists, and many more. So, if you're new to the podcast, we are live on 9 different platforms alongside YouTube, such as Anchor, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, Breaker, Overcast, Pocket Cast, Radio Public, and finally Stitcher. So, make sure to go check them out. As always, when I'm doing the Student Art Podcast, I like to give artists a shout out and share their work on the podcast. So make sure to include your portfolio links, whether it's ArtStation, whatever your main website is, if it's Wix. Share it in the description below in the comment section on YouTube. Obviously, if you're listening on the other platforms, you can't do that, unfortunately. But if you also want to share your work, you can also tweet me. At Baxter95, so that's B with a capital B, BAXT3R95, and I'll include the links in the description below as always. And as I said, I always give artists a shout out. It doesn't matter what level you are. It's at the end of the day, it's about getting more comfortable about sharing your work, and also I also like to give people more the attention they deserve. There's a lot of great artists out there who don't get the attention or have not received the attention yet that I feel that they deserve, and sometimes maybe a wee bit of exposure might help. Obviously, I'm still quite a small channel. I do thank everyone who's subscribed. We're currently, I think, like 1,200, 1,100 subscribers. So it'd be much appreciated to if you guys subscribe and also like the video. And I'll do my best to share your work and also my social media platforms as well. It's what I always do. I share the links. I spam them all over as much as I can just to help you guys out a little bit, or as much as I can. So on today's episode, today is going to be a very in-depth video. So I highly recommend, if you're listening, to maybe get a piece of pen and paper, because we're going to be covering a lot of different things from online schools in general for art and the creatives, online events, magazines, websites, you name it, YouTube channels, podcasts, everything. And this is basically to provide you with different range of materials to help you. Just remember, one of the biggest mistakes I've always noticed, though, about me doing, for example, about things like this, so when people do share massive loads of information with artists, is artists tend to get, obviously, overwhelmed by the amount of information. So the one thing I highly recommend when you're listening to today's episode is take notes of the things that you think are going to be the most rewarding. So don't just note down everything. Obviously, I will include the links in the description below, as always. So if you do want to go check these links and material out, then you're obviously, you can go do so and explore the things that you need to explore and get better at. But obviously, there's no pressure. Also, when you're listening to today's episode, note down what you need to note down, and if you come across anything new, then great. And that's at the end of the day, the important thing. It's about learning something new and something fresh. And if you do know everything I'm about to say to you, then kudos to you. Great, that's awesome to hear. And if you guys have any other sources of material, websites and so forth that you think would benefit artists, please include that in the comments below. That'd be much appreciated. As at the end of the day, we should all be helping each other to grow and improve. So let's just get straight into the episode. So the first thing we are going to be talking about is schools, online schools, and tutorial websites. So when it comes to me as an artist over the years, I've now been doing 3D, I think, nearly 8 years. And I've came across so many great websites out there that has allowed me to just improve overall. So, for example, there's Pluralsight, which used to be Digital Shooters, and I came across this whilst at university. So Pluralsight is an online tutorial service. It's almost like a mini school in a way, except obviously it's through tutorials. And it provides a lot of great sources for you to grow as an artist. Obviously you have to pay, but I do believe it's a good price, and based on the amount of content that you do get, I think it's about £30. Don't hold me to that price, but I think it's around £30. So that's Pluralsight. There's also Lynda. Lynda, I think, is mainly for animation. I'm not an expert. I'm just when it comes to Lynda. I think it does cover also a lot of range of tutorials. So Lynda, that's another one. I've heard a few of my friends do tutorials from that in the past, and they said that that they enjoyed it and it was good. So check them out. Schools that are really well known are like the Game Art Institute, Gnomon. They're two of the really big hitters when it comes to just the industry, when it comes to the creative stuff. And then personally, one of my favorites, like the coolest, like one of the coolest schools I've ever seen, I wish I could go to it, is Feng Su's school. I'm not sure how you pronounce it, if it's FCD, so Feng Su Design. And there's also a few things I'm going to talk about Feng Su later on, like, because he's one of my favorite artists. He's a concept artist. If you've never heard of him before, make sure to go check out his work. He is literally a master. He's amazing. He's an incredible concept artist with such diversity and range of skill. So highly recommend checking out Feng School. This is actually a new one I came across. It was literally just today. It's called Schoolism. It's another online creative school for concept artists, and just once again, it covers a vast range of different topics. CG Workshops is another one. Ctrl+Paint or Ctrl+Paint. And CG Masters Academy, that's another famous one. It's a really well-known one. And another one of my, another school, or should I say tutorial service that is actually pretty new, but it's a great one, is Learn Squared. Learn Squared is this awesome online tutorial school. I think it's like online teaching as well. So it's online teaching, tutorials, and a few other things. And Mache, I think it's Kusiara, one of the biggest concept art legends to me personally, based on what he's done for the creative industries. He's done so much, and he's had so many great, I guess, artists brought on to Learn Squared to teach you guys. One of my favorite concept artists is Aaron Lemonic, and he's a concept artist at Naughty Dog, and Aaron has thoroughly broke down his process as an artist. He's also done that on the Gnomon Workshop, which is another one of my favorites. So the Gnomon Workshop, which is the one that I go, that's the one I use. So the Gnomon Workshop is the one I pay for monthly, and I think I'm paying around, I think about £33 to £38 a month. But the resources that I'm getting for that kind of money is great. I've learned a tremendous amount through a variety of different artists, such as Devin Fay, I believe it's Devin Fay, and a few other artists who have taught me about lighting. And for me, obviously being an environment artist, lighting has been such an important part to my progression as an artist. And Gnomon Workshop has provided me with that stronger foundation. So there's a few things I'm going to be talking about in regards to the Gnomon Workshop later on, in terms of my latest project. So I've recently just finally finished, I say, a train project. So I've been working on this train, this massive train project. It's been taking ages. I think it's like 6.5 months it's taken me to make, but it was definitely worth it. I had a blast making it, and it was because of all these online sources that I've been able to, I guess, go up that extra level. And this is the one thing that artists have to start acknowledging more, or if you're new to the creative industries, is that sometimes you're just going to have to invest. Obviously investing time is crucial, but investing money sometimes is the main way to progressing forward as an individual, because if you don't know what's required when it comes to, I guess, creating the final image. So for example, with me, one of my favorite things just in the world is creating realistic art, or as believable as possible, and giving it that sort of cinematic aesthetic, and obviously providing a story. And through my investment, I've been able to improve because of that. And that, and the day, it's about obviously knowing, I guess, your situation, so how much money you have, getting told the right information as well. That's always been an issue, I guess, just with things in general, is sometimes it is very difficult to find the right information, because there's so many, I guess, websites and links and tutorials and services out there, and you're pretty much just you get stopped, and you have to start asking yourself, well, what one's going to benefit me the most? Is it worth it? There's a lot of things that come into play, and that's why I always like to keep things nice and simple, and I kind of like break things down. That's why I said at the start of the podcast, identify what you think is going to be the most rewarding for you. Obviously, it's important to explore, and it's important to try new things out. Great, go ahead. That's what you've got to do. However, you also have to realize you have to be realistic as well, and understand your boundaries. Obviously, it's great to take risks in terms of, like, if you think maybe there's a new source out there that could help you, and you think investing a wee bit of money will get you that extra step ahead, then give it a go, take that risk. But there's a lot of people who obviously maybe don't have the financial backing behind them, and therefore it's always important to make smart decisions. And I'm a great example of that, because I've learned a lot from a lot of the mistakes that I've made, but I've improved because of them as well. So, like I said, so that's a lot of the school online schools, the tutorial services, such as Pluralsight and a few others. Right, this is another one that I've always liked to, I guess, bring up, because I still think there's not as much focus on them. Maybe I'm completely out of the loop, and I'm living, I don't know, hidden in a bush or whatever you want to call it. But magazines. So magazines is such an important one. So there's four main magazines that you as a creative should be looking at, whether you're a concept artist, whether you're a 3D artist, an animator, you name it, explore these four. And the four I'm going to talk about is Empire Magazine, which is actually purely around film and games and so forth. But I guess the three main ones is ImagineFX, 3D World, and 3D Artist. So these three are like the top of the top of magazines when it comes to the creative industries for film and game. And I've actually had the privilege to recently, I didn't even notice until actually today, ImagineFX has released an article, my article for me about the Student Art Podcast and my time at Vertex, which is an event that I attended in March, I believe. March, 8th of March. And that's another thing we'll be talking about, is events. But because of magazines, you get to get up to date with trends. Like, obviously you have online tutorials, which is great. However, it's the 3D magazines and the concept art magazines that kind of highlight the instant or current trends at the moment. Like, they always bring out something fresh, because everyone's always trying to learn the new thing, and magazines identify those things for you. So for example, like I said, it's because of me coming across things like Vertex that I was able to then to explore into ImagineFX and realize like what they have to offer. And they offer tons of different things, from all the things I'm talking about just now, like learning material, new processes, certain names in the industry that are like rising, like people who are being successful, different stories. And that's great, and that's what you want to learn, and that's what helps you as an artist improve. So make sure to check out, mainly I would say, those three things. So ImagineFX, 3D World, and 3D Artists. Okay. So this is the next one is kind of, I guess, the obvious one, or the one that I guess we all relate to, which is just like your common websites for artists. So the big and obvious one is ArtStation. I guess it's kind of almost industry standard now to have your website as ArtStation, or it probably is, to be honest. Obviously, there's some people out there who use Wix. However, in terms of games, like this is the main thing. Just remember, if you're going into the game industry, I highly recommend use ArtStation. Obviously, film like it as well. However, film, their go-to is Showreels. Believe it or not, they're still using like things like Vimeo, and Vimeo is great for showreels. So if you're trying to get into VFX, I highly recommend you creating yourself a showreel and getting yourself on Vimeo. Game artists, however, if you're trying to get into games and maybe other creative fields, ArtStation, that's the go-to. For me, I've always been passionate about both of them, games and film. So what do? I simply have two. You have both of them. You have ArtStation, and then you get your Vimeo out there. Some YouTube is okay, I guess, for your showreels. The only thing is, though, is that you want to make sure that you avoid all, I guess, interruptions as possible, and Vimeo provides you with that option, and that's why it's more easier to and safer to go with Vimeo for that sort of process. The next one's obviously is Google. It's the main one for reference, as everybody uses. Well, personally, I think the main one's actually going outside. That's the one thing that we as creatives have to start making sure that we prioritize more over images online. Obviously, we can get inspiration and we get our passion from great artists from looking online. However, nothing beats going outside. Another one, obviously, is Pinterest. It is obviously another website that provides great quality images. So if you are looking for good maybe reference for texturing or stuff to use as, I guess, just inspiration if you're a concept artist, or just anything to maybe symbolize motion for animation. Sometimes there's good posing on Pinterest from actual models themselves. Another one is Polycount. So I've been using Polycount, it's got to be about 5 or 6 years now. So Polycount is like an online forum, and basically everyone can showcase their work and have discussions with people and get feedback pretty quickly, and everyone shares their work. There's some people who give very harsh critique, but sometimes that's what you need when it comes to improving. Obviously, at the end of the day, we should all be helping each other as best as we can, but Polycount is a great online source. It's slowly not getting used as much as it used to be, I kind of feel, based on my own experience. However, I still use it because it's helped me out tremendously over the years. Another one is Concept Art World. It's another great website to check out for yous who are concept artists. But also, when I'm saying all these different websites, just remember, this applies to all of you. That's the one thing that a lot of people who, I guess, are maybe new to the industry or are so attached to their own industry, they forget. So being a creative person, you can explore all different things to improve you as an artist. So learning things from animators will provide motion in your concept artist, in your concept art, if you're a concept artist. Learning how all these different things work mechanically, sometimes exploring. So I used to do animation. So I went to a online school called Animation Mentor. That's another one. I didn't realize I missed that out. Animation Mentor, highly recommend it if you're an animator. Go check that out. Absolutely amazing. And it's because of learning animation that I was able to improve story in my artwork and just creating emotion. And it doesn't have to include words or music, but by simply understanding how posing works can improve your story with an environment or a character. And that's what you have to realize as an artist, is appreciate all these different forms of creativity to just fill you up with energy and different ideas. And just by opening your eyes and looking around you as well. A lot of people overcomplicate things. I used to be one of those people that used to always think there had to be a more complex method to start to making things look good. But sometimes it's just the simple things that make it look great. So explore those different things. Another thing is an old one, but it's an obvious one, is DeviantArt. So I highly recommend checking that one out. And a very growing one at the moment is 80 Level. A few of my good friends have wrote a bunch of articles for 80 Level. One of my good friends, Kevin McKenna, make sure to go check out Kevin's work. Kevin is an awesome artist. He works at Ubisoft. And Kevin had the privilege to write an article for 80 Level when he finished university. And it was an awesome one, highlighting his process of how he created his, it was like a medieval sort of castle, and it's an amazing art piece. And 80 level basically gathers all the best artists or the people who have made certain artwork and ask them to highlight their process from start to finish. And one of the main things I learned from Kevin, Kevin was actually been on the podcast before. Go check out episode 4 of the Shooting Art Podcast. You'll hear a lot about Kevin's journey. But Kevin did a really great thing, and this is the one thing I highly recommend for game artists. When it comes to game art, one of the main things that these game studios like is obviously your low poly, your high poly, and that. But that's the obvious things. But the one thing I've realized has made everything kind of like, or how could I say this? Like, one of the main things that game studios like is things that are like, my mind's gone flat for a second. What is it? What's the phrase? Ross, come on. Think about it. Screw it. We are resulting to Google, and we're checking out Kevin's work, because this is one thing that I highly recommend for all of you guys to be doing if you're trying to get into games. Or I think it's a great thing to do anyway. Right, let's have a look. Where are you, Kevin? Let's see. The joys of the internet's brilliant. Here we go. Okay, making modular artwork. So in Kevin's piece of work, he made a modular art piece, and he focused on making it ready for games, ready for engine, so Unreal, and getting himself into like Ubisoft. So modular art pieces are really good for game industry. Another one is panorama pieces. They're awesome. Highly recommend them as well. They're really good. And obviously focusing on efficiency. Okay, where were we? So we were talking about 80 level. And the reason why I obviously brought up Kevin is because the article they wrote for him, and like that Kevin also wrote, obviously, it provided me with a strong insight to how things actually worked and what they were looking for. So make sure to go check that out. The next one is one of my favorites, but it's just because of me as an individual loves to do this, which is reading. So I read a lot of books. I do as much as I can to read a book a week, but as of late I've been trying to focus on a variety of other things, so I haven't been able to keep up to my usual. But through reading, it has allowed me to grow my imagination so much. And through reading, it's helped me write my own book. So I'm currently writing my own book at the moment, and exploring my own world. So, and that's another thing to give a go, because you never know what might come from it. Give it a go. You won't know unless you try. So reading, highly recommend reading. And if you're one of those people who are listening and you're like, I hate reading, then what do? You go to audiobooks. You can't beat a good audiobook. I love audiobooks as well. I actually went back to listening to the original Narnia books, and it was so nostalgic. It was so great to hear that world again and hear about the books. But instead of me just rambling on, we'll just continue, because I could talk about Narnia and all these other great franchises for ages. So another one, which is a massive one, is the Rookies Award. So the Rookies Award here covers literally everything. So everything I'm about to talk today is another big one. It's another one of the main websites and materials out there for you as an artist. So I actually had the privilege to talk to the founders of the Rookies Award in episode 11, I think, of the Shinara podcast. So if you want to go and check out what the Rookies Award is in depth, I highly recommend checking out that episode. But to give you a bit of brief context about this subject, so the Rookies Award is an online competition, which is, I think it covers, I would say at least 6 creative fields. So what do I mean by that? I mean like game art, architecture, VFX, animation, and I think there's a few more. I think at one point they were trying to dwell into or dive into fashion, but they were also trying to make sure that they didn't lose sight of their main focus, which was game and film. But the two founders, absolute legends, had the privilege to meet them and talk to them, and it's something I highly recommend you check out. The great thing about the Rookies Award is obviously it gives you the opportunity to not just showcase your work, but have the chance to get an internship. So if you're currently out there and you're listening into this podcast, just one thing I highly recommend you go do tonight. Apply to the Rookies Award. So you've got a month to go. So the end date, I believe, for submissions is the 28th of May. So I've recently just finished my submission for the Rookies Award, and I was fortunate enough to be selected for the draft selection. And it's taken me 3 or 4 years to get to that selection. Basically, the draft selection is like the second or the highest, well, it's like the highest selection of artists from the competition to be put, to then be narrowed down to be chosen into the finals. And so when I first entered the Rookies Award, I started off with a level C. So what does that mean? That means that they thought my artwork at the time, so based on their system, so I think there's like 7 grades. So it's like, or when it started, there was 7 grades. I think it's like F, E, all the way up to A, and then it's like something else, like excellent award or something. So there's all these different rankings. So I was, so when I first started off, or when I first submitted, I was like the middle rank. And at the end of each year, I was like, I need to improve. I need to know where I'm at in regards to comparing myself to others or the competition I have surrounding me. So I entered the Rookies Award. And then last year, I got the level B. So I went up an extra rank. And then this year, I went up 2 ranks, and I've finally been selected into the draft selection. So one thing I highly recommend, or it's the reason why I ask you to apply to this, is because it tells you the truth. It showcases you right now where you're at as an artist. So if you're a concept artist and you're like, how do I compare myself to the other students who are currently applying to concept art roles, and what am I doing wrong and what am I doing right? And through applying to this, you simply get the truth, and that's what keeps you clear-headed, is just knowing the do's and don'ts of what you need to do to get where you need to get. Does that make sense? I think that made sense. Yeah, I think that's clear. Cool. Awesome. So make sure to go apply to the Rookies Award. Like I said, you've got a month left, and make the most of the opportunity. Like I said, portfolio, so the presentation is very important, how you lay things out. Another thing when it comes to artists in general is they tend to keep things in their portfolio that they shouldn't. You have to be able to identify what's good and what's bad. Be honest with yourself. Sometimes less is more. Don't always think that you need to have 1,000 things in your portfolio. Too many people fall into that trap. They think that they need to just jam everything at once and think that instantly makes them better. But then they forget. The one thing these studios and games and film judge you by is by your weakest piece. So if you have a weak piece in your portfolio and you can clearly see it's a weak piece, get rid of it. You don't need it anymore. It's okay. And plus, it'll teach you the important lesson that all artists have to go through, which is being able to accept when an art piece is bad or not strong enough. And it's okay to have a weak piece, because at the end of the day, we all have a weak piece. Like right now, I know I have a weak piece in comparison to my other projects, but in regards to overall, it's okay. It's doing decent. It's not too bad. Because I've finally chucked away the things that are definitely way too bad. I've been like, right, that sci-fi piece is a scratch. I don't like that. It's a complete no-no. The texturing's off. The lighting's not as cinematic or as accurate as it should be. It shows no story. There's no context. Then what do? You wipe it away. You get rid of it. So the Rookies Award, make sure go and apply. So the next one I want to talk about, I'm going to be spitfiring a bunch of YouTube channels. There's obviously tons and tons of that I can talk about. But for this episode, in regards to the content of this episode, I'll say about 15. There's probably about 100 out there, but your minds will be fried listening to me talk about all these different ones, because there's so many awesome material out there. So one of my favorite, if you're an artist, it doesn't matter what type of artist you are, I highly recommend go check out the podcast Art Cafe on YouTube. Once again, it's the incredible Maciej Kusiara, I think that's how you pronounce it. I apologize, man, if I'm pronouncing your name wrong, but he has been creating his Art Cafe podcast for years now, and he's brought on a vast range of amazing guests. And through learning their story, understanding the type of work that these guys have done, it has provided so much understanding of the industry of to me in terms of how it works and like the do's and don'ts, how different games and films are, all the sources out there at the moment, how software has changed over the years. There's a lot of great information that Maciej has brought up through his podcast. And for me as an environment artist, one of my main passions obviously is seeing concept artwork. You guys are concept artists out there. You guys are amazing. I love you. Just keep drawing. You guys are doing you guys are doing like legendary work. You provide me with inspiration every day. Every time I see new things on ArtStation or Google or whatever it is, it really inspires me as a creative. And through watching the Art Cafe, I have been able to learn a stronger stronger understanding of the fundamentals and what creates a good image. And that's another thing, as artists, we have to start learning, especially environment artists. Just remember, obviously, when you get into the environment art position, whether it's in game or whether in film, obviously you won't be asked to design things like fully or whatever, because that's down to the concept artists. However, you do have also a voice as well at times, and being able to understand all the important things of design and form follows function and how things work, whether it's mechanics or understanding composition, like the beauty of composition. You can't overlook composition, the appreciation of lighting and color grading things as well, the golden rule, golden ratio, whatever you want to call it, and how to maybe create something more cinematic, whether it's through adding atmosphere, depth of field, motion blur, camera settings and stuff, like how does a camera work when it comes to rendering. Oh my god, I can talk about this for ages. There's so much stuff that you can learn from just concept artists and how to make a stronger image. So highly recommend checking it out. Another one, I really hope that Gavin Golden brings it back. So the Character Art Podcast, I think they have 11 episodes at the moment. So Gavin Golden is the head character or head art director at Insomniac Games. So he's made games such as Spider-Man, so many great games in the industry, and he's been such a huge support to everyone who's been creative. And his podcast is the Character Art Podcast, who he does alongside two of my favorite artists, John Trinico and Lena. Both John and or Troy, I think he prefers getting called Troy, and Lena both do their Twitch streams as well. So I highly recommend checking out their Twitch streams, because they're both sculptors. They're the owners of I Has Toys, so they do collectibles and very stylized characters. Troy was originally at Weta, so he was one of the main artists and designers of some really incredible pieces. So he made a very iconic tree beard sculpt. He's also done World of Warcraft characters, but he is mainly known, and his passion is female characters, and he makes amazing, beautiful characters from that. So check out Gavin Golden, John Trinico, Lena Lazar. Lena Lazar also has a YouTube channel of all her stylized art. So if you're into stylized art, make sure to go check out Lena. And yeah, and I'll let you guys have a little bit of a breather, because you've been listening to me for ages. Right, well, that's a 2 second breather. Let's get right into it. So the next one we're going to be bringing back the main legend himself, Feng Su. Can't get a bigger name than that. He's a great artist. I've learned so much from him. His YouTube channel, so go check out Feng Su channel. I think it's just Feng Su, Feng or FZD channel. And he talks about all his process on silhouettes, form, function, atmosphere, and in terms of how he can apply that to his concept art. He also talks about his school. He showcases his school and the students that he's taught, and the end of year exhibition that they have in, what country are they in again? I'm trying to think. I've completely forgot. But anyway, it's an amazing amazing school that this place is. And if it's actually a thing that maybe you want to look into and maybe go to the school, I highly recommend checking out the website. It's awesome. So another one is the Blender Guru. So all you Blender artists out there, or any artists out there, the Blender Guru is a person who's been doing YouTube for years. He's been making tons of great content on his channel. Obviously, it's regarded Blender, but that's the thing about the industry now. It's the software is just a software. However, he has provided his own input in terms of design, and you can learn from his channel as well. And if you're an environment artist and you're thinking about learning Blender, then go check out Blender Guru. Two of the obvious ones: Pixel Logic channel and Gnomon channel. Two of the biggest names when it comes to just the creative industries as a whole. They've provided some really great guests. So Gnomon, everyone, if you're not listening, if you've not heard of Gnomon, is the one thing I've talked to you about today, go check. Gnomon is like the top of the mountain. It rules the mountain at the moment in my eyes. Obviously, there's a lot of people who have different opinions on certain things, but Gnomon has taught me a lot, because I also have a passion for character art, and they've brought on guests from everything, from Star Wars guests, from people who worked on Guardians of the Galaxy, Game of Thrones. You can't beat Game of Thrones. Like, seeing how they made like Game of Thrones, and like the process from the green screen to the final post processing and the VFX, it's amazing. And the Gnomon school and Gnomon channel provides you with that to see how it actually is done. So make sure to go check out both of them. Another one, which is he's been doing it for years. I think it's Mike Hermes. He's been teaching the fundamentals of 3D for, it feels like, gotta be 10 years. I might be completely wrong, but he's been doing tutorials for years. And I highly respect this guy. He's been constantly bringing out new processes and new ways of how to just do 3D, whether it's how to make a trophy, how to make a shield, how to make a sword, you name it. He's taught you how to make it. This person has been teaching the fundamentals of Maya, Max, Substance Painter for a long time, so highly recommend checking out him. So another one when it comes to the film and just game, I guess, in general, is CG Bros. So CG Bros, what is it? It is people who've submitted their showreels and more to CG Bros to showcase their work and how they've created their work. So CG Bros is a YouTube channel that highlights a range of different artists. I also remember one of the videos was actually a person from my university, Albert A. He got accepted to be put onto CG Bros, and I'm pretty sure they're on a few million subscribers. They're a massive channel. I might be completely wrong subscriber count. I'm pretty sure it's two million. It's something mega crazy, but by watching these showreels, you learn how to set things up. If you're trying to get into film, showreels is your go-to. So how to make something presentable is so crucial. So make sure to go and learn from that, explore those different things when it comes to the showreel side of things. Another one, this is just a random one that I think helped me, is short films. So type into YouTube short films for VFX, and you'll learn lots of different things, and you'll create different stories to just help you overall as an artist. Next one is Flipped Normals, another online one to check out, so make sure you do that. That's in our YouTube channel that covers a lot of different stuff. Next one is my good friend Sir Wade Neistat. He's an animator, YouTuber. He's on 50,000 subscribers at the moment. He's been flying, he's been growing up there. He's been making great content for animators. And he does tons of teaching. He worked at DreamWorks, and he talks about his whole journey of how to become an animator from start to finish. He talks about interviews, and I actually had the privilege to bring him on the podcast for episode five this year in our podcast with Sir Wade. So make sure to go check his name out, if you're an animator, highly recommend it. Another one for Pixel Logic is the Pixel Logic Twitch channel. So they bring on, I think, I might be wrong, but it's like three different sculptors a day. Is it constantly live? I might be completely wrong day-wise and time-wise, but they have there's not been a time that I've been on Twitch and not seen Pixologic live, because they're on it all the time, because I think they base it around time zones from everyone over the planet. So there's been a tons of great artists, from 3D printing artists to digital sculpting artists, for concept, for film, for game, you name it, they've pretty much showcased it. Next one. So this is the last list of things, which is the events. So what we're going to talk about is, so I think the biggest event out there at the moment for games anyway is obviously GDC. So GDC takes place each year in America, and I've never had the privilege to be there myself, but hopefully one day I'll be able to go over and see it for myself. But everyone that I've heard from, my friends and family and people who I went to school and so forth with, who's been, has always talked so highly about it. It's a great event to go to. So check out the GDC. So the one I went to in March, which was Vertex, it's a relatively new event. It takes place once a year in London. So they bring on guests from Frame Store, so people who've made like Harry Potter, The Martian, all these big companies in London and so forth, and all the software developers as well. There's live drawing that takes place there as well during the event, and there's a lot of guest speakers. So I had the privilege to meet one of my idols, Christian Mance, who directed the Fantastic Beasts films, and you've listened to the podcast, I'm obsessed with Harry Potter, so I was it was happy days. It was great to watch his process and his journey of how they made the CGI shots of Fantastic Beasts, and it was because of attending Vertex that I was able to not only get a portfolio review, but I was able to learn so much about how the industry was run for film, and that was so important for me to understand, because if I didn't go to that, I wouldn't have known that, and it would have slowed down a lot of my process and journey as a creative. Another one is FMX. I think that takes place in two places. So I think its original one is Germany, but it's also happening in London. I believe it's next week or in 2 weeks' time, so it's really soon. If you've not got tickets yet for the one in London, I highly recommend it. You to go check that out. Another one of the really successful ones, events around the world, but this one mainly takes place in Portugal. I'm pretty sure, I think it's just they've branched it to a variety of different things, but it's Trojan Horse Was a Unicorn. Such an awesome name. Trojan Horse Was a Unicorn. Can't get any more badass than that. That's awesome. What a name. Such a great name. They've been doing things for years. I came across this awesome event actually because of Art Cafe. Miche actually brought on the main founder and talked about his process and about what it was like in Portugal, and it was great to hear what these people have been doing with Trojan Horse. So if you're in Portugal and you're listening to the podcast, or anywhere in Europe, or if you can get yourself to Portugal, boom, go over there. It's awesome. Highly recommend going checking it out. Another one, which is an obvious one, but it's one that you shouldn't ever say no to, is actually E3. Obviously E3 is for everything games, whether you're an Xbox person, whether you're a PlayStation person, or just game artists in general, seeing the new games and the new trends and the new things that are happening, whether it's technology-wise or just games in general that are being released, check out E3. I've been dying to go. I wish I could go. I can't go yet. I've got too much stuff I'm planning at the moment, but if I ever get the chance to go to E3, it'll be awesome. Another one, BFX, so in Bournemouth in UK. It's another awesome one to go check out. The next one is actually one I've never heard of. I think it's called Click, and it's in Amsterdam. And this one I actually came across today, and I think it's for just games. I might be wrong on that. I didn't explore too much into it, but it did look very promising based off the research I did, because it said that it was in the top 10 of events globally, so it's clearly a very successful one. So make sure If you're in Holland, go check out that one. That's another great source for you. And the last three things I'm going to talk about today is something that I guess is used for concept artists and environment artists. So it's three things that are just simply tools to improve user creative. So concept artists. Remember, in the word concept, the main thing is obviously exploring different shapes and designs. So it's not about making it personal. It's in terms of your personal, like, you don't have to be so precious about how, owning every single shape or every single line in the image. So the one thing I recommend all concept artists to explore with are models. So using models to block out your scene. You don't always have to make the models in 3D. So by using Turbo Squid, you can buy and purchase models. Obviously, it depends on if financially wise, like how much money you have in that. But sometimes purchasing models improves or speeds up your pipeline production speed. And if you have to get something out quick, sometimes importing a model that's already been made will really speed up your process. So it's the same thing, obviously, that applies to kit bashing. So if you're trying to explore different shapes or trying to get something out really quickly, kit bashing through models is very important. So check out Turbo Squid if you are in need of maybe different shapes and designs to help you improve overall. And finally, but not least, is the two other things I recommend for environment artists. So I came across this through talking to Raphael on, I think, what episode was it on the podcast? 15? 12? I've done so many podcasts, I've lost count. I'm trying to remember where, when I talked to Raphael. So Raphael is an amazing, brilliant Brazilian artist that I brought on. It was so awesome to talk to him, but he introduced me to the discussion of megascans and speed tree. So megascans, obviously, megascans, it says in the word, scanning of objects and things in real life and so forth to help provide more realistic artwork. I'm pretty sure that's how the megascans work. And then speed tree is a speed tree tool to create trees, obviously, and organic artwork. So that's another thing I highly recommend for environment artists to explore. So, with all that said, and your minds are fried right now, I really hope today's episode have helped you guys in some shape or form. I know it's been so much to take in, even my head's exploding right now with all that things discussed about. But I really hope that's helped you as an artist. And as always, folks, don't forget to subscribe. Make sure to smash that like button. Also, to give you some context on next week's episode. So next week's episode is going to be episode 20 of the Student Art Podcast. I'm bringing on an incredible lighting artist who works at Cloud Imperium Games. She's amazing at what she does. So make sure to go check out next week's episode.
Thank you.
You're welcome. It's going to be a good one. I'm so stoked for it. As always, folks, don't forget to leave a like and smash the subscribe button, and I shall talk to you guys
next episode.
Thanks for listening.
You don't even know how you feel. It's adorable. Well, it's nice to see that humans never change. Open your eyes, let's begin. Yes, it's really me, it's Maui, breathe it in. I know it's a lot, the hair, the bod. When you're staring at a demigod, what can I say except you're welcome for the tides, the sun, the sky. Hey, it's okay, you're welcome. I'm just an ordinary demi-guy. Hey, what has two thumbs and pulled up the sky when you were waddling yay high, this guy? When the nights got cold, who stole you fire from down below? You're looking at him, yo. Oh, also I last. So the sun, you're welcome to stretch your days and bring you fun. Also, I harness the breeze. You're welcome to fill your sails and shake your trees. So what can I say except you're welcome for the islands I pull from the sea. There's no need to pray, it's okay, you're welcome. I guess it's just my way of being me. You're welcome. Welcome, welcome to think of it. kid. Honestly, I could go on and on. I could explain every natural phenomenon. The tide, the grass, the ground. Oh, that was Maui just messing around. I killed an eel, I buried its guts. Sprouted a tree, now you got coconuts. What's the lesson? What is the takeaway? Don't mess with Maui when he's on a breakaway. And the tapestry here in my skin is a map of the victories I win. Look where I've been, I make everything happen. Look at that me, mini Maui. It's okay,
you're welcome.
Well, come to think of it, I gotta go.
Hey, you're welcome.
Cause I'm gonna need that boat.
Hey.
I'm sailing away.
You're welcome.
Cause Maui can do everything but float.